Good morning, everyone. In 5 minutes, we will start with this workshop. Thank you for attending. So please call your colleagues and please find a chair. Thank you. What a silence. Wow, fantastic. So thank you very much. I see that everyone is has found a place. So thank you for attending. I would like to introduce this meeting, saying a few words about my personal thanks to all the people that are present here today and for the future days. And I would like to thank the local organizing committee for hosting us here in Monte Mario. It's very important for us, for having a good workshop, to have teleconferencing systems and chairs and whatever ready to to host you and us, etc. And I would like to thank, in particular, also the SOC that organized this and helped a lot in this organization. Unfortunately, I have to apologize for our president, Professor D'Amico, that unfortunately have a really important appointment that, at this time. But he said that he could join our workshop the last day, when probably we will have also the scientific director that will say some words about the vision of INAF in this particular field. So thank you, everyone. And let's start this workshop with the contribution of Riccardo that will explain in detail the aim of this meeting. Thank you very much. Okay. Okay, so thank you, Riccardo. For the people that does not have the EduRoam, please find here. There is the password for the Wi-Fi connection. And you must. So, and also the toilet are here in front of the, on the left side of the lift. Okay? Thank you.
Okay, just a few words, just before starting all the presentation, about the INAF Science Archive, that is a very important meeting for us. Also because we're starting from the LOC, the SOC initiative, and there is the first successful point is to have 18 participants to this meeting for all the people interested in INAF, and not only with some external invited for this meeting. I just want a few words, because I don't want to take time to discussion and I want to take time to the presentation, that remember that the main point of this meeting is just the discussion between us, discussion which is that because we need strong interaction without us, because there is a lot of world, because we're talking about, we know that we need a strong interaction between computer science, astrophysics, astronomical, and astro anything science. And because the data is important, this is a famous order because we talk about 2014 graph. It's important because in the future, and it becomes all in the future, data from the archives will be the main font, the main point from when that scientific publication will be used. So science will use mainly from data from archiving where they don't have or they don't are PI from the observation. So the main target of this meeting is use case, status of the current archives, what will be the new archives and the future archive. So we need networking, and we need mainly, not only when people are working about archive, but also computer science, the feedback for the science community, because many times, also we saw in the meeting last week about spectroscopic laboratory and so on, we need more interaction between technical part and we need the science part, because usually you are two different worlds. This world must become one. This world must be collaborate together, because there is two main world: new world is old world, the open science and the data lake. This is the topic world that in this time, in the last 2-3 years, but actually we see all around when you walking around during the conference, during the international meeting, or during meeting with our agency, founding agency. Open science means fair, means interoperability, means long-time preservation. Data lake means archiving, structural and non-structural archiving, means data store, means user workspace. So all this world will be our future. Our future because like a starting point, we must remember that the target is just an example, is SKA. SKA, there is a big amount of number about data, about the storing data, and of course, storing data is not only how I save the data somewhere, but is how I can use this data in the best effort, in the best mode for the community. SKA is just an example, because we are talking about exabyte, zettabyte, or so on data. But it's just an example, because you have a long tail of science about data, because having good infrastructure about data in general means that a big project, a long tail of science, can work with the best effort for the working. So I know that we talk very fast. I hope that you understand something. And I will start with the workshop, because I remember, discussion is the main point of this workshop, and networking too. It's not just a presentation or something like that. Thank you very much.
So the ideal speaker, because stop in time, and also previous the programmed timing. So if you have some question about the goal of this workshop, please raise your hand and say, okay, I don't understand something, or okay, I think that we can go on. The first speaker of the session, except the introduction one, is the UTG2, so the radio astronomy, with Alessandra Zanichelli. Thank you, Alessandra. So if you want to close this.
Okay, thank you for inviting me to give this talk. I'm speaking today on behalf of the Radio Astronomy Division of ENAF, and I will try to review what is the experience and the challenges that we are facing now when handling radio data within ENAF. This is a short outline of my talk. I will try to describe what are the main radio astronomical facilities in which ENAF is involved at different level, both from the international and the national point of view. And I will go then to describe the Italian radio telescope network, which is now fully operational, and the realization of what is the radio astronomical archive for ENAF. I will close this presentation with some of the challenges that we are now facing and which are quite common to any modern archive in the epoch of big data. For what concerns the international landscape, I will go very fast because there are many other talks dedicated to the main international facilities in which ENAF, through the Radio Astronomy Division, is playing a role. So I just point out some of the talks that will review in more details this instrumentation. But to start with, of course, as Riccardo just said, the SKA is the main infrastructure of the near future, which will see a role of ENAF for what concerns data archivals, but archivals of new generation. I want to mention, speaking about pathfinders and precursors of SKA, I want to mention an already existing contribution in the field of data archiving made by the Italian Astronomical Archive Service in Trieste for the Murchison Wide Field Array. They are storing currently the public data from MWA. This has been a test of connectivity, but indeed can be maybe the start of a future or a prosecution of this collaboration. Of course, LOFAR. LOFAR is really an important telescope for Italy in this moment. You know that Italy will enter the collaboration with a station based near Bologna in 2 years from now. The involvement of ENAF and Italy with the collaboration also of the University of Torino at the moment comprises the realization of a short-term archive which is currently used mostly for data processing, but in the near future it will be needed to start thinking about how to archive data coming from the LOFAR Italian station when operating in standalone mode, which will take 10% of the telescope time. Finally, but not less important, there is the involvement in the ALMA, the millimeter array in Chile, and in particular I want to mention the contribution that ENAF is giving in the reprocessing of ALMA archival data to try to maximize the exploitation of this very, very important data archive. Moving to the national landscape for what concerns the handling of radio data in a structured way, maybe what's the first example of an Italian archive of radio astronomical data is this one, the Trieste Solar Radio System, which started its operation many years ago and had a stop in 2010, but is now starting again its operativity. This is a project devoted to quasi real-time solar monitoring and distribution of information regarding the solar parameters, and it's an important application for space weather, which is a hot topic at the moment at many levels. But the real focus of my talk, of course, speaking for the Radio Astronomy Division of ENAF, is the Italian Radio Telescope Network. We are now in a position in which we have three fully steerable antennas. There is a further instrument, which is an interferometer. I will not discuss it. I can say some words to some of you later if you are curious. However, ENAF is now managing three fully steerable antennas, which operates on a national level in a coordinated and harmonized way. This required a lot of effort from the staff in the two places where these telescopes are handled. And this realized the Radio Telescope Italian Network. This network can operate in very different observing modes. just to review briefly what is possible to do, they can operate as a single telescope. Each one of them can operate as a single telescope, just delivering their own science, and of course producing data with defined format that are common to all the telescopes. The three antennas regularly observe within the VLBI network, in particular inside the European VLBI network. But in the last years, there has been a huge increase in the number of experiments involving what we call AVN subarrays of telescopes. That means a smaller number of the AVN antennas working together outside of the rules of the AVN collaboration, and quite often involving also arrays from East Asia. And all these data are handled by ENAF or partners. Must be handled by ENAF and partners. A short word on another observing mode, which is common for the two smaller Italian antennas. Geodetic observations are done within the international context, within this worldwide network, but are also done in some cases, again, with a smaller set of antennas on a local basis, and must be dealt with in some way. Finally, but not less important, there is the huge contribution of the Sardinia Radio Telescope to pulsars observations within this LEAP collaboration in the EPTA framework, mainly devoted to study of gravitational waves through pulsar observations. So we have this wide number of observing modes that are possible with our telescopes. I don't think you can clearly see the upper picture, which is very black, but we have to deal with many different data types. What I want to say is this: we have to deal with single dish data taken in total power or spectropolarimetric mode. We have pulsar data, which have their own characteristics, and we have the VLBI visibility fringe data that we have to store all together in a common way within a common archive if we want to maximize the scientific exploitation of this data. So this motivated us to start a collaboration with the ENAF Astronomical Archive Service in Trieste, and we started to work towards an archive which can be scientifically exploited by the community on a national and international level. And of course this involves data preservation, data curation, in order to encourage also the scientific collaborations of scientists around the world. To the same, and given the complexity of observing modes that I already showed you, the first very important part of the work that has been done in Trieste has been the definition of a common data model to describe all these various types of data that we have to archive and handle. This part of the work has been the core of the archive at the very beginning. And this is just to give you an example, a view of the overall scheme of the archive. This is how the archive works. The important information here is that there are some activities, some operations that are local as the data ingestion part, data are ingested locally at the telescopes, and data storage itself can be made locally. Then we have a common part, which is the database itself, and the web portal, which is accessible from a unique access point to the community. This is at the moment, just to show you an example, the web portal. You see, you can do different types of searches depending on the data type you want to look at, or you can make also a more general search. We implemented an authentication and authorization mechanism to be able to guarantee the proprietary time to the PI of the projects in order to make this archive useful not only for the general users, but also to the PIs of the observative projects themselves. current challenges. We are now populating this archive. We are filling it with the data from the last semester, so we are ready to start the public activities. And we are now facing some questions. We want to maximize the scientific return of this archive, not only for the radioastronomical community. We want this archive to be profitable also for non-expert in the radioastronomy field. We are archiving raw data. Keep this in mind, because at the moment we are archiving raw data, and radio raw data are not that easy to look at in comparison with, for instance, optical data. So our big challenge at the moment is how to make this data discoverable and usable. And this also, keeping in mind that the big data problem is entering the game also for us, and I will come back to this very soon. I'm going to show you three examples of these challenges that we are facing, and I will also shortly review the ways that we devised to face these challenges at the moment, or at least the questions that we are asking ourselves and maybe the community to try to address these challenges. The first one is the discoverability of data, and of course the framework in which to act is the virtual observatory. We decided to explore the requirements of the OBSCoR model of the virtual observatory to try to put our archive in this, let's say, worldwide scheme and make our data accessible to the international community. This step has been done, and we are ready to publish our data using these descriptors. So, in principle, our raw data could be already visible within the virtual observatory framework and well described. We also provide some services, we implemented some services to access the data through VO protocols. We have, at the moment, implemented TAP and Data Link, and this is crucial in particular when you want to connect ancillary information to your data. Ancillary information, which is ancillary in the name but not in the fact. And what I mean is that you need that ancillary information if you want to process your data fruitfully. And now we go to the big data problem that we are facing, even with the Italian radio telescopes. This problem is common to what is happening in other worldwide new generation interferometers, of course, on a much smaller scale, but the problem is the same. I'm showing here three examples of a real case of what is produced by three different observing modes. And I want to draw your attention in particular on what happens with the SARDARA spectrometer, which is commonly used at the SRT and will be used very soon in the next months also in Medicina. This is the most used receiving system on the telescopes at the moment for single dish. It delivers typically an effective data rate of that order, 160 gigabytes per hour. So here we are facing a situation in which in one day observation or in 10 hours observation, this data become very huge, very difficult to manage in a classical way, with a classical approach. Pulsar data also can be very huge data sets, depending on the mode you perform the observations. And VLBI, apparently at the moment, are not a concern, but this is strongly dependent on the number of antennas taking part in the network observations, because the higher the number of antennas and the exponentially increasing is the size of the data that you have to deal with. So the second challenge is how to make this data usable. I cannot imagine with this kind of data sets that a user connects to the archive and download data, then at home try to look at them and see if they are really what he needs for his scientific purposes. We need to provide online descriptors and metrics in some sense to allow the user to be able to evaluate the importance and the usability of that data before trying to download them. This must be done both for the Pulsar data and single dish data and VLBI data. And here is an example of what I mean when I speak about instrument characterization and effective metrics to describe the data. These two are kind of descriptors, let's say, that are provided by the EVN archive when you have a look at the data sets stored there. They provide you with some meaningful information, which is a sort of quick look of the scientific content of the data. Take, for instance, the plot on your right side. This is the UV coverage that defines immediately for a radio astronomer, but also for a non-expert radio astronomer, or astronomer in general, the resolution that you can get in your observation and the quality, the coverage, the quantity and detail of the image information that's in there. We have to define and to find out which kind of descriptors are more suited for the different observing modes, and we have to provide these descriptors online through the archive to the users. The third challenge is, once you have seen if that data are useful for your science, maybe you cannot think to download them and reduce them, process them locally on your computer because of disk space, but also computing resources can be a concern. So the classical way that we are using now when reducing data, that is providing some, let's say, observatory tools to the observers to process those data, like the three examples that are shown here for mapping or spectroscopic spectropolarimetric observations, RFI cleaning, and so on, these tools will not be useful in the future as they are now. We need to find a different solution, which again relates to something that has been anticipated by Riccardo just now. We need to start thinking, even within this Italian archive for the radio telescopes, we need to start thinking about how to provide this user space, how to configure this user space, what's the aim and the operations that will be done within this user space. We have to work to transform what are currently offline tools and transform them in pipelines, automatic pipelines for data reduction. We have to develop, of course, new software and also analysis tools to assess the quality of what the pipeline are doing. Also, users can would like to provide their own software sometimes to perform some operations on the data. So there must be a way in which this is possible. That means defining a standard way of operations, standardization of procedures. We have to control the data flow within all this process of exchange of information between the user and the archive. And also, at the point in which we will be able to run these pipelines on the archive, we would like, hopefully, to be able to archive the products of this processing. And that implies a strict definition of a quality control procedures and also a description of the provenance, the overall provenance of the data and data products. These are the three main challenges that I just wanted to mention as the main, let's say, concerns for us at the moment. And this, I think, will be the topic of many discussions within during this workshop. So just to summarize my contribution, I hopefully have been able to give you the message that even for the Italian radio telescopes network, we are now facing similar problems to what is happening on a much larger scale for the new generation radio instrumentation. We developed this archive, and we are now in the phase of trying to address the problem of big data and big challenges, how to manage this data efficiently, how to make these archives something more than an archive, a completely new approach and vision of what is an archive. And the last sentence I just wanted to put here is that maybe, given that we are facing all these new points of view on the data, maybe this Italian archive can also be seen as a test bed or a preliminary experience to gain expertise towards what will need to be done for future instrumentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Alessandra. Of course, stay here, please. So, questions? Please? You have to repeat the question because of the registration.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Alessandra, you were saying it's difficult to make the raw data searchable. What about if we save into the archive some sort of standard reduction results? Then people can look at the results and decide, okay, if they know that this result is coming from this data, they can understand, I would say, more easily if the raw data have some interest for them or not.
Okay, the question is, given that raw data are difficult to, if you want to understand if they are useful for your science, wouldn't it be better to archive some standard reduced data to have a first assessment of the scientific usefulness of those raw data? And the answer is yes, of course, this would be the right way to go and where we want to go. But before being there, we need to define pipelines and procedures and sort of low level, at least, quality control, because even if you want to give a sort of pre-redacted data without worrying too much on the data quality, however, you have to control the operations that have been done and publish this information. So, of course, yes, that would be for us the, let's say, final point, and hopefully we will be able to get there.
Angelo?
I didn't avoid actually this very important project for radio astronomy in Italy. I just mentioned it briefly in this slide because I know that there will be a contribution by Marcella Massardi, who is the manager of the ALMA Regional Center in Italy, and she will talk about the importance of the ALMA archive, and she will tell us many things about how much or how little this archive is used as it is now, and that's why she proposed this REL project to maximize the scientific return of this archive. Of course, the ALMA Regional Center is one of the, let's say, most important infrastructures for radio astronomy in Italy, definitely.
Other questions? I have one. Alessandra, how difficult it is to produce an automatic pipeline, in the sense how much it is reliable, how difficult it is to choose proper data, or you have to adapt the data to your reduction or vice versa. In the sense, sometimes the human intervention is needed to produce really science data. So is it the same with the radio data or not?
Yes, under different aspects with respect to what happens for optical data, but of course the intermediate check of the various steps of data reduction is important. maybe I'm biased because of my interests, but I'm thinking about, for instance, the handling of the radio frequency interference. It's a huge problem for us, and we need to clean it properly to obtain good science from the data. And this, I think, is one of those steps that will need some sort of interaction or interactive level within these pipeline processes. The interactivity maybe is one of the most critical parts of creating an automatic pipeline. At which level you want to be interactive and how much you want to be?
Okay, sorry. The countdown, sorry. Okay, thank you very much. There are other questions? Fast, very quick questions? Not for the moment. Thank you very much, Alessandra. Let's go on with the next speaker, Matteo Perri, that will talk about the UTG 3. So, planetology, etc.
Thank you. Yes, in this contribution, I will give an overview of the ENAF science archives in the high energy band. On behalf of Massimo Cappi, which is responsible of the high energy astrophysics division of ENAF. This is an outline of this talk. I will first briefly describe the UTG3 national division of ENAF. And then I will introduce the Space Science Data Center, where the archive activities in the high energy band of ENAF are located. And finally, I will give an overview of the main ENAF archives for high energy astrophysics. Okay. National Division of High Energy Astrophysics of the below the ENAF Scientific Directory deals with all the high energy missions and observatories, where high energy here stands for X-ray and gamma ray energy bands. So we start from 0.1 keV to over 300 TeV. These are more than 12 orders of magnitude in the electromagnetic spectrum, so it's a very wide energy band and very different kind of instruments and technologies. These projects can be divided in the space missions, mainly related to space agencies, of course, the Italian Space Agency, ESA, and NASA, and the ground-based observatories at very, very high energies. These are the ground present and future Cherenkov telescopes. Of course, all these projects include past observatories, which are very important in this context, since we know that science research based on our archives is very important, so data preservation and curation. Ongoing observatories present, and these hopefully will go also over the 2025 time frame. And there are several also future observatories in the second decade of this, in the second half of this decade. This is a list of the major past and present high energy space missions in the X-rays, BepoSax, Chandra, XMM Newton, Integral, Swift, and NuSTAR, both from Italian Space Agency, NASA, and ESA, and two space missions gamma ray, in the gamma ray band, Agile and Fermi. And ENAF is deeply involved in all these projects. And in particular, I have highlighted here in red the missions where INAF plays a major role in the management of their scientific archives. But the INAF activity is not restricted to only to the archives. We have also an important involvement of INAF in the several other activities. INAF is a PI of missions or instrument, COICE, responsible of calibration, and also has developed data analysis software for several missions. For what concerns the future, this is a complete list of future space missions in the high energy band. We have XPE to be launched in 2 years, the first imaging X-ray polarimetry, Athena, Theseus, Hermes, XTP, and ENSVOM. And for the present future, very high energy ground telescopes, MAGIC, and the ASTRI, and MINI-ARRAY, and the CTA. Also, for these projects, we have an important role of INAF in the archive management for XPE, Hermes, the ASTRI, MINI-ARRAY, and CTA, as well as other activities which are listed here. Okay, so the archive activities of the high energy division of INAF are based mainly at the Space Science Data Center here in Rome. The SSDC, which is a research infrastructure, which is managed by the Italian Space Agency, ASI, together with INAF and INFN. And the mission of SSDC is clearly to is related to data acquisition, management, processing, and distribution, and with the goal to enhance the scientific data return and to ensure long-term preservation and the curation of the data stored in the archives. Very briefly, the SSDC is a facility founded nearly 20 years ago. It was formerly the ASTC. It started from the experience of an high energy mission, the BepoSAX, in the 90s, and currently it has operated or operates more than 25 space missions, and a significant fraction of this mission are the high energy ones. So it's very important in this context. The SSDC involves around 40 people, both archive scientists from ASI, INAF, and INFN, and software engineers from Telespazio and CERCO. And the SSDC approach is an effective one. That is, the archive scientist and the final users of the archives belong to the same community. And as I said before, the high energy is an important part of the SSDC projects. Just very briefly, the SSDC is organized involving three different research institutes, ASI, INAF, and INFN, and with the fourth important component, currently Telespazio and CERCO, which provides information and communication technology support. I want to stress that currently over 15 INAF scientists from the Astronomical Observatory of Rome are located and are working full-time at the SSDC, and this includes 9 staff. Okay, now let's move towards the archive. The main science gateway is through the SSDC website. We have here science tools to online access of data in a multi-frequency environment. And here you see some a subset of the missions from which users can access directly to the data. There will be later in the afternoon a talk by Fabrizio Lucarelli going through several details and scientific use cases. Here I just want to show you the multi-mission archive provided by the SSDC. That is a single page from which all the archives can be used at the same times. In particular, here I've highlighted the X-ray and gamma ray missions. And just as an example, this is a query return for the CRAB, for the CRAB data in the archive. This is organized in a table listing all the missions and the usual cake. And the approach is to provide the users a uniform interface from which the first step is data access, of course, but very important is to provide also a preview of the high-level scientific data products. And most importantly, also, there are several online interactive applications allowing users to have a quick look at the data and then again enhance the scientific return of the data. Some consideration about a past mission, BepoSACS, for which the archive is available since the very beginning of the mission. The archive includes more than 1,500 pointed observation and includes scientific data for all scientific instruments, the narrow field ones and the wide field cameras. And the content of the archive also includes previews of high-level products, for example, sky images, energy spectra, and light curves for a quick inspection of the archive, and also interactive analysis tools for the LEX and MEX instruments. This table just shows the result of a query for again for the CRAB data in the BepoSACS archive. Each row of this table refers to a single pointed observation of SACS at the CRAB. We have several observation, and through this dynamical table, there's the possibility to directly download the data, but as I was saying, we have the possibility to have a preview of the sky images. These are the CRAB images of the low and medium X-ray energy band from the LEX and MEX telescopes. This is the energy spectra fitted with a power law by five distinct instruments, and this is a light curve. So this allows a very quick view of the content of the archive. But on top of this, we have also the so-called interactive analysis, which allow the users to do some science. This is an example of image analysis. This is again the CRAB, and in this left panel, users can change the size of the image, the energy range, can overlay entries from multi-wavelength catalogs and other things. And also, starting from this event file, it is possible to interactively do a spectral fit or a light curve with some basic analysis tools. This is all done using the SSTC servers, so it is a live analysis. And all this kind of approach has been developed more than 20 years ago at the BepoSACS Science Data Center. SWIFT is a very important X-ray mission. Now is almost 15 years in orbit. We have at the SSTC, managed by ENAF with ASI, an official mirror of the archive. The master archive is of course managed by NASA. This is a very rich archive, more than 200,000 points of observation. SWIFT is really a very efficient observatory. It includes scientific data for three distinct instruments, the wide-field BAST alert telescope, the X-ray telescope, and the ultraviolet optical telescope. And also for Swift data, we have developed at the SSTC application interactive analysis tools for XRT and UVOT, and which is we have also a quick local archive. This is an almost real time, about 30 minutes after the telemetry downlink in Malindi at the quick look archive at SSTC. You have the possibility to retrieve the data and apply the analysis tools to the data. And also we are responsible for the development of the data processing software for the XRT instrument, and this is the software used actually to generate the archived by NASA. And this is just an example of the content of the Swift archive. This is for an AGN, Macarian 076. And as in the case of BepoSax, we have direct data access, but also interactive tools. This is for the XRT, again, image analysis. So this is a quite deep observation. You can see that, for example, here, a source detection algorithm can be run on fly. We have several detected sources. This is the target, of course. And for each of these sources, this is possible to extract and analyze online the energy spectra and the light curves. And also on this user, there will be this will be covered by Fabrizio Carelli later this afternoon. NuSTAR, also the first hard X-ray mission carry on focusing telescopes. We have the official mirror, scientific data for both NuSTAR telescopes. We have developed interactive tools, and also for NuSTAR we have developed the for NASA the data processing software. And and as you can see, the user interface is very uniform. You have data access and interactive analysis. This is an image of Cassei, and this is an example of a energy spectra directly extracted from that image. And this is a light curve. At higher energy, we have the Agile archive. Actually, the Agile data center is located at the SSTC. The archive includes data for the grid gamma ray instrument and also for the super Agile hard X-ray instrument. For Agile, we have as well the quick look archive. And the so-called level 3 archive, which includes pre-compiled counts maps, exposure and background maps for a very efficient, easy, and quick analysis of the archive. And there are specific applications for the interactive analysis. Again, this is the table for the Agile archive. And this is an example of a very quick image analysis that can be done from these online tools. And also, Carlo Pittori was supposed to give a talk, which actually will be given by Fabrizio Lucarelli later this afternoon with a lot of details. For what concern Fermi, also, we host the public data archive of LAT. This is the number of photons as of yesterday stored in the database. Also for Fermi, we have a quick look archive. In 2-3 hours, we have new data. The possibility to do some online analysis, conquery on specific sky positions, data preview, online analysis, and light curve photometry, the generation of photometry light curves. So this is an example for the light curves. And this is an a quick preview of the Fermilab data obtained from the SSTC archive. And finally, going to very, very high energies for what concerns the ASTRI and the MiniArray, which is an enough end-to-end project for the realization of a prototype of a dual mirror Cherenkov telescope, and in the near future, and a mini array of 9 ASTRI telescopes. This project includes also the complete data handling system and an ASTRI data center. In this plot, you can see on this side the archive activities carried out on site at the observatory site. Following after data acquisition, the on-site archive of, where level A and level B analysis is done. But then the off-site archive, the data center in Rome, where level C analysis pipelines are run, which provide the so-called ASTRI gateway for the data distribution to the users. And a few details on the ASTRI data center. The first is important to stress that the pipeline has been developed within the Horizon 2020 ASTRIX project. Again, it is an end-to-end approach, and the archived concept has been developed within the Horizon 2020 Indigo Data Cloud project with the concept of the distributed archive. There is already data present in the archive, the Monte Carlo ASTRI data, real data from the ASTRI prototype, and also the scientific simulation from the ACDC projects. And in this distributed archive, it already includes 3 nodes, one located at the Observatory of Rome in Monte Porzio, one at the Frascati National Lab Laboratories of INFN, and the SSDC, and they can be expanded to include other nodes. And additional details will be provided by Saverio Lombardi. And finally, for what concerns CTA, based on this on the same idea developed for the mini array, the concept is the one of a distributed archive. And Stefano Gallozzi will provide will give a talk later. So this is a summary of my contribution. I want to stress that in the high energy astrophysics, ENAF is deeply and widely involved in several projects. And for what concerns the archive activities, these are mainly based at the Space Science Data Center here in Rome. In particular, several science archives are hosted there. The SSTC multi-mission archive is offering a uniform user interface for data access, but very important to provide tools to quickly analyze and to enhance data scientific return by means of specific interactive tools. Okay.
Thank you very much. That thanks our speaker. So, questions? Yeah, please.
Is there a possibility of programmatic access to the archive?
Programmatic,
the web interface.
Okay, we have the possibility to download the data through scripts. So this is possible. For the online analysis, this is not possible since the approach is an interactive one. We're thinking to do something to allow some, for example, a subset of the archive. So.
Other questions? No, I have one, sorry. Basically, as far as I understand, of course, your data are already calibrated one. Is it possible also to rerun the pipelines in order to, for example, have another version of or newer version of the pipeline over the system?
Okay. Yes, I didn't mention that the archived content includes raw data and calibrated data, and also we provide the possibility to reprocess locally the data if new calibrations or new algorithms in the software are available. So yes, this.
Okay, thank you very much.
I think it was.
Yeah?
Just to add a comment to what you were saying, after saying the answer to Dino, that what Matteo said is completely true for the IMG data, on the, but for example, for the IA data, you can access also via the different server, so you can access the data very efficiently.
So for the, okay, please.
Yes, just under comment, we mark the importance of the availability of data that are present in the archive since very long time. So we have seen that was us. So we started with data from 20 years ago. So this is important in order to...
really preservation. Okay. Sorry for this interruption. What was the shadow? Okay. Let's thank our speaker again. Thank you. So next speaker is Simone Silvestro. Let's talk about the storing and processing planetological data. So UTG-4. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon. So today I'm speaking for the UTG-4 about storing and archiving the planetological data. So I start with a brief introduction about the instrument, INAF instrument, and all the missions where INAF is involved in the exploration of the solar system. That I'll give some hints about the data processing of these different kinds of data and the different pipelines that are used to process the data. And I'll talk about archiving, so where all this data from different missions are stored. So we have actually 15 INAF instruments on about 11 missions. Some missions are ongoing, some others are terminated, some others are future missions. And we have different bodies of the solar system, which are the target of the mission. So the solar system is well represented, as you can see in these slides. We have lots of missions that are going on and planned for Mars. Then we have Jupiter, Saturn satellites. We had a mission on Venus, Venus Express, then asteroid and comets, Earth and Mercury. And we have different types of instruments. Most of them are camera and spectrometers. Then we have ground penetrating radar and other kinds of sensor. We have Micromet, which is a dust sensor for the surface of Mars, and an electric field sensor for Earth. So different kind of things, but camera and spectrometers are the most represented type of instrument. So now I'll start talk just to introduce about just introduce the data processing, and there are different pipelines for processing the data. The main pipeline, which is freely available for all the community, is ISIS, which is the integrated software for imagers and spectrometers, which is led by the US Geological Survey. Okay. So most of the data from camera should be processed through these through ISIS, which is not really a program, but is an environment with several programs, which is freely available to the community. In addition to that, most of the team also developed their own processing, their own processing pipeline. Okay, so in some cases, we are still not sure if for submission the data will be processable with ISIS or not, is to be determined. While for others, we already know that the data are usable with ISIS, so we can pass from the raw data to the scientific data by using the ISIS pipeline. Okay. So talking about the proprietary pipelines, so the pipelines that are developed by individual instrument team, most of them are developed at the INAF YAPS in Rome, which has a lot of instruments which are actually on several missions. And we have other two pipelines at the INAF Astronomical Observatory of Padova. I will speak a little more in detail about one of these, the CASSIS one, because I'm in the team, so I'm more used to this pipeline and interface. So as I was telling before, USGS ISIS is the greatest software for imagers and spectrometers. How does it work in general? We have different levels of data processing, level zero, level one, A and B, level two and three. So level zero is normally the raw data. We add to the raw data some information of the position of the spacecraft, the targeting, and then we can convert the raw data to level one A or B data, where we remove noise. I'm mostly formatted on images, so I'm speaking mostly about images, so we can remove noise and artifacts. And then level two and three is the level of the data where we have, we can, to each pixel of our data, we have latitude, longitude, and the data is is projected on a map projection. Okay, so this is basically the different stage of processing that we have, the processing level that you can have in ISIS, which are the same of the what NASA define as the main processing levels, which are valid for most cameras and spectrometers. So what I want to point out here is that we have high level data, level three and especially level four, where we have multiple information, multiple data set merging to do to have a data that we can use for science, okay? For instance, stereo or 3D models of the terrain, which will they use which for 10 that we need two different images or something like that. I will speak about that a little bit later. And then the archiving, so where these data are stored, okay? So we have global repositories, which are the ones leaded by the main international space agencies, the NASA Planetary Data System and the European Space Agency Planetary Science Archive. Then we have a local repository, because our national ASI-SSDC, we talked about it just in the previous talk, and then we have several local repositories in INAF, and then we have others repository, but I don't have really information about those, the Chinese Space Agency and IKI Roscosmos, the Russian Space Agency, have their own repository, okay? So the planetary data system of NASA is the biggest repository. So the aim of the planetary data system is to store in the long term the different data sets, and it has raw data from level 1 till level 4 and beyond. So it is organized in 8 main nodes. There are six science discipline nodes: geoscience, atmosphere, rainbow system, etc. And there are two support nodes. Okay. Each of these six science discipline nodes, for instance, I put here an example from the cartography and the imaging science node, has their own web interface through which we can sort, choose, and select the different data that we want to use for doing our job. As you can see in this example, you can sort the data by instrument, target name, latitude and longitude of a specific body, and then you can also sort for each instrument, for each camera, spectrometer, the different filters, so we can simply choose the one we are interested, the one we are interested in. Okay? So all the data that we had from the missions in which INAF is involved should be should be stored in a planetary data system, okay? Or in the planetary data system on in the Planetary Science Archive of ESA, which has the same requirement of the planetary data system. So we need to organize the data in a way that we can store the data there, okay? So there are standards, of course, that we have to respect to store the data there. So a typical PDS data product has data object, which should be an ASCII or binary format file. And then we have a primary data object, which is the data in itself. And then we have secondary data objects, which are ancillary data that describe the main data. And then we should have a label, which is written in object description language, and which accompany the real data and give further explanation to the data. Okay, so here we have all we need to know to characterize a specific data from a specific for a specific mission. Okay, and this is an example of a label of that of an image in the planetary data system. Just to give you an example, I've highlighted here. This is the label, the primary data object, which is an image, lines, sample, etc., etc. And then the secondary data object, we have here, for instance, an image histogram or a table which characterizes better the primary data object. And poi here we have the main label, the main header. Okay? So, also the planetary data system as a way to organize the data, which are different from the NASA processing level. So we have processing level from 1, 2, 6, 7, 8 to indicate from the raw data to data that is actually usable for science, which might involve the link of many other data. For instance, a geological map is the result from different data, camera, spectrometer, different model of the terrain. So in the PDS, we can find from the raw data till the most processed and usable data ready for science. Okay, this is the takeaway point of this slide. And then we have the European Space Agency Planetary Science Archive. So fortunately, it uses the same standard as the PDS. Okay, so once we prepare the data that is ready to be stored in the PDS, is also ready to be stored in the Planetary Science Archive of the European Space or the European Space Agency. Okay, and also through this the web interface, we can select the data that we need by sorting all the data by the name of the mission, by the bodies that you want to analyze, and so on. And then we have the Italian Space Agency, the Space Science Data Center. So you already seen some slides about it in a previous talk. I just want to point out that for the planetological data, you have a web tool-based interface called Matisse, where you can choose and sort missions, bodies of the solar system that you are interested in. So, okay, yeah, don't be scared about this slide, but as you can probably understood from what I say now, in planetology we don't really have a single way for a single repository for archiving data. So we have different missions, and everybody has their processing pipeline or this way of archiving data. We have several repositories also here in INAF. What I want to point out here is that normally the high-level data products are stored locally in INAF repository or at the main repository of the Italian Space Agency, because normally, with the exception of the Virtis of Rosetta, where the European Space Agency asked to have high-level data product on the ESA repository, normally there are no special special requests about the high-level data product. So everybody is storing high-level data product in its known in its own institution. Okay. Now, what I do mean when I speak about high-level data product in planetology? So I introduced before that 3D model of the terrain, we call them digital terrain models. So those are a high-level product because for producing this kind of product, you normally need two different images taking a different angle to reconstruct the terrain. So for instance, in these images, here you have images where the color represent different height, and then you can put on top of the image of this model, the images, you can see the 3D of a specific surface, and we have in INAF mission many cameras that do that, which are stereo cameras. Then we have spectral map, okay, so where different colors here represent the abundance, different abundance of specific minerals, and then we can merge everything together to make a geological map which help us to characterize planetary surfaces on Earth as in other planets. So when I speak about high-level data product, I normally intend this kind of product that I just showing, that I'm showing you in this slide, okay? And I just want to point out here that we have a repository at the Observatory of Padova. We have a CASSIS, which is the co-API ship is in Italy, in INAF, in Padova. It's a stereo camera, so a camera through which we can generate digital terrain models, 3D models, and as its own web GIS interface. So you just go to the website of the repository. You see a nice map of Mars with the footprint of the Cassis image data. Then you can select, you can see where the footprint are acquired, and you can also ask for having a DTM generated. And you can mix also the footprint with footprint of other instruments, so you can have an idea on what there's in a specific area, in this case of Mars, and you can request to the team to produce a digital terrain model for you. So in conclusion, as you can see, most of the instruments, INAF is volar camera and spectrometers, and each institute has developed different processing pipelines. But there's a common processing pipeline that is USGS ISIS. The team are often encouraged to produce data which can be used through this free pipeline led by the US Geological Survey. So there is not a common policy on how to release high-level data product because different missions, different policies. And that these high-level data products are normally stored in different repositories. So my opinion is that it could be nice to have a common repository, maybe nice enough to have all the high-level data product for the for planetological data. And it could also be nice to have like the repository in parallel that I showed you before, a GIS-based interface, like there are on Earth, for instance, for Earth data, NASA Giovanni or JMARS. I show you some example here. With this web interface, you can simply, you know, select an area where you are interested in and download the data you are interested in. Okay. For Mars, we have JMARS, okay, which is a GIS-based interface. When I say GIS is a geographic information system. Okay, so you have a map, latitude and longitude. You see the footprint of the images of the data that you are interested in. You can go there, select. Through JMARS, you can also do science, actually, because we have different layers that you can overlap and you can download what you need, or you can directly use the WebGIS interface to do to the science. Am I using it? No, not really. I prefer to have my data with my own project, but I know many people that is using it. And sometimes I use it also to have preview some data. And then you have other, for example, you have the Mars Global Digital Do Database. You are able to log online, download the data that you want. In this case, are the dune fields on Mars, and then you cross this data with other data. So it could be nice to have, you know, something like this, some web-based interface to have all planetological data in with different bodies. And that's it. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, very interesting. I was surprised about knowing about this policy that is different, but it exists.
It is. Yeah.
Because sometimes in other countries except Italy, the policies are private forever, for example. So yeah. Have you got some question about the planetological data in particular? The speaker? Yes, of course, please.
Probably we talk in a private way, but just to introduce a few things. One, concerning the pixelization schema that you use to have these points basically on a spectral surface, because I see rectangles that is definitely not the best way to pixelize a spherical surface. The second, regarding the metadata schema, I don't know how old is this schema, but of course nowadays JSON would be a much better way to code metadata.
Okay. About the first question, what you have seen is just a preview, so just a global map to see where the footprints are. Okay. Speaking about, for instance, JMARS or the interface of Cassis data. So it's just a simple way to view where the footprints are. Now, after, when you see that this footprint is in the area that you are interested in, then with ISIS, you can decide the projection that is more suitable. For instance, if you are close to the pole, you might want to use a polar projection and represent your data, you know, on as a polar projection, or you want to use a sinusoidal projection, or you want to use a Mercator, by knowing that each projection have distortion. So on the base of the area where you are in this body, you need to use different projection, and you will do this with ISIS. So this, what I showed to you here is just a preview, an easy way to visualize the data. Is it clear? Okay, sure. And then for the other question, there I think you should talk with some NASA guy of the planetary data system. I cannot really answer why they're using this way to labeling the data. What we know is that this is the way, and we should be compliant if we want to put the data there.
And one last question, very easy.
Sure.
If you have never heard about the OpenVDB, Open Volumetric Database, okay, it's made by DreamWorks, the animation stuff. It would be very, very, very suitable for handling this sort
okay.
of data.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, thank you very much.
Okay, please answer questions, yes.
So since there are many different repositories, I guess that interoperability is a key point for what is the current status of implementing interoperable services?
So I guess for interoperability, you mean how the different repositories talk with each other. Yeah, that's a good question. In reality, it seems complex, but in reality is really not, because you know that in the PDS there's everything, okay? And you know that what you put in the ESA, Planetary Space Science Repository, the way that you put the data there is the same as the PDS. Then. Everybody, I think, has a different way of doing. For instance, me, I never use the PDS. When I need a specific image or a specific camera, I go directly to the site of the camera and I download the data that I need, okay? But, the different repositories are separated. I'm not really aware if they can talk with each other. But the main point, it seems complex, but at the end you have several ways of downloading your data, and you can choose the one that you like the most.
Okay, other questions? Ricardo?
This one?
Yes, this one, okay. So, just one question was about, we already to talk about nice to have, and that's the high level repository in Ina. This is, I think, the request that Ina should be taken answer about that. But when we talk about the repository, I think you're talking about and when you create archives,
the raw data.
Because what I understand, final data is delivered to ESA, of course, because of the data. But also, intermediate data is delivered to ESA or just only in the local repository in INAF? And which is the amount of this local repository should be having in INAF? Because, of course, you're talking about the biggest number about the SKA, but we don't know about which is the amount of data that arrived. How much is I used and released.
Yeah. So, speaking about the software for instance, the USGS ICES is totally free. You can just download it, put it to your PC, and make it works.
But
it's a bit tricky. Say it again. As far as I know, there is no license. I mean, then I'm not really a data expert, so I should look at it. I mean, but you can see the scripts which are processing the data, and you can eventually modify them. Okay, so I think this is what you are asking for. Okay. Then for the amount of data, yeah, there are a lot of gigas and gigas of data. We are talking about different terabytes is the especially for Mars data where we have a lot of mission and a lot of data of really high resolution in some case. Higher resolution compared to the data that we have on Earth. So we're talking about teras and teras and teras.
What do you mean about easily accessible?
Sorry?
What do you mean about easily accessible?
Yeah, I'm thinking about an interface. A web interface. But this is my opinion. Here I'm not speaking about, the old. Okay. Yeah, of course. Of course. Yeah. You're welcome.
Question? Other questions? Past questions? No? I have one, of course. is the virtual observatory present in the NASA applications and portals, etc., or is not considered till now?
Considered.
Not used and neither in place.
Yeah.
Okay. But do you think that could be useful to compare or to open the public search over data?
Probably.
Okay.
Probably.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So I think that now we can have the coffee break and then we restart with another session talking about the status of our INAFET and Italian archives. Thank you very much. In 20 minutes, or about 20, 30 minutes. Okay.
Okay, we start with the second session of the day, and with Cristina Knapic, that will speak about Italian Astronomical Archive Facility.
Bye. Thank you very much. So I will try to be very fast and not talk about all the features that we offer in the sense of detailing all the archives that we handle, but to open some questions and present some data cycles, data life cycles. So in introduction, this is our main page. We handle both ground-based telescopes as well as simulations and survey archives. I would like to introduce you to this sketch that presents some introductory suggestion in order to understand better how is the data and the science investigations. So it, everything starts with the proposal to some facility, in our case ground-based telescopes, and continues with the instrumentation details, observatory, which kind of infrastructure they offer and which kind of instrument tools they offer, then the data archives, the analysis of data, the collaborative tools that helps the users to properly share information with other colleagues and collaborators, etc. And then you got the publication of your results. Oops, sorry. First of all, IA2 helps some telescopes to handle also the process of registering users and submit the link between the proposal ID and the PI name. This is very useful because it allows the people to assess both the proposals and also the data once they are observed. This tool is was developed firstly for the TNG telescope and works offering some features. I don't want to spend more, but it is very important that the user is registered. That's not mean that is obligation, of course, but it is much more easy for us to handle all the cycle, the data cycle. Then we got the instrumentation. The instrumentation is developed by scientists that focus their activities over performance of the instrument, but also we have to stress on the importance of filling all the data that the instrument produces with all the information for the data retrieval and the data reproducibility, of course. So also the schedule, of course, the scientific exposure, the image spectral description, so the metadata, the calibration exposure, the engineering data, and the night shift are very important information that we would like to collect in order to present data in a fair format. So to do this, the most important activity that we carry on is the continuing interaction with data providers, that means the instrument and telescope people, to evolve data models, so filling properly the data with all the information to find data over portals or VO compliant services, etc. And then we got a continuous interaction also with the standard experts. That means what is proposed by the IVOA has a recommendation as well as the standards, was proposed by the RDA or the FAR principle or the open access, etc. Then we got the observatories that has pipelines, usually offer also the calibration, and of course they perform the data quality. So for them, for the observatory as a whole, we offer the store of data for long-term preservation. We also store data in a temporary repository. We perform the data distribution, of course, and the data online archive. That means that the data are immediately available through our services and portals. And then we serve the data in VO-compliant manner. That is very a key point for IA2. And allow operation on data in a user space, so you can store your data in a user space and download also after several time. And then we got also, we allow also the computation on data. That is very important because if you want to reduce your data, you have to have the availability to perform it over server side. And then we got the possibility to interact with other collaborators using collaborative tools and perform additional operation over data. And then there is a DOI, that is a facility that Riccardo will talk on Wednesday. Just a brief mention of our infrastructure. We got about 800 terabytes of online archives. Then we will very soon, next month, probably have the tape library of 12 petabytes. That is for the asynchronous call, of course, for big data. And for that, I was mentioning about Pulsar Search or Sardara data. Then we got infrastructure from our own installed in other facilities, like for example, the SRT and in AIRA, because we would like to make some experiments also in data handling. And also, in of course, those facilities has their own infrastructures for data distribution, etc., and in which we can in which we can deploy our services. So also, AIRA has again about 40 terabyte for radio distributed archive. Sardinia Radio Telescope, now we are updating the system to about 60 terabytes. Serra La Nave, they are updating the system to reach 360 terabytes, and Serra La Nave, and LBT, of course, and Asiago, that is the has several telescopes, and we handle also the data of the Padova Observatory. And then, of course, we need the bandwidth. And in Trieste and in Bologna and CRT, we got the connection to the 10 gigabits on GAR. I would like to stress on this perspective, what is the data provider for us? The data provider is both the telescopes, as well as the projects for simulation or surveys, as well as the users. And I would like also to mention that we handle three kinds of data. The structured one, that usually are the data acquired at the telescope. The partially structured data, that are the products of what is the ongoing activity of the user or the PI to reproduce data, etc., to calibrate, etc., and the shared data that is completely not structured but is a collection of information that is relevant for the reproducibility of data but is not inserted in a well categorized way. Another information that I would like to share with you is the nomenclature. What is a data collection? A data collection is a systematic approach in order to standardize and allow the people to assess the information in a unique way. Okay? So you can have a collection of homogeneous information that could be analyzed in a new unique way. So, if you adhere to this standardization, you can have accurate data collection that is essential to have to respect the FAIR principles. I don't want to spend more time because there are other speakers that will talk about the FAIR principle, but I would like to stress over the impact of the faulty of this principle. This means that we got the inability to answer research question accurately and inability to repeat and validate the study. Okay? That's very important. What is a data collection? Well, the data collection is the topmost container for grouping related data. In which way? We got data models, that is an abstract model to organize elements of data. Okay, so we got reference in the data model, and we got a data set that is a part of this collection. That is very important to be to adhere to one data model for each collection. What we are dealing in year two, Currently, we had conversion in data model from some standards. But for the future, we plan to adopt the CAOM from the Canadian infrastructure in order to be as much as possible compatible for the beginning with the virtual observatory. That is very important for us. So we have the standards that drives the definition of the data model, and in this sense, the CAOM include most of the standards in the astronomical field, of course. And then we got the publication of that data over both VO compliant services and web interfaces. Let's try again. Okay. Okay, let's try again. So what is very important for us and what is the aim of IA2? So we would like to, and we do it, store and preserve astronomical data. That's the initial goal. Support data providers. Okay? Okay. I must go. Yes, we would like to support the data providers in order to build. Let's go on. So, we would like. It's my present. Okay. Okay. Proviamo. Quello? Ok. Oh, vado avanti, per se non ho... So, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So, we publish the data in... thank you. But the activity that we also do is support astronomers and PIs, etc. in data retrieval. That means search for the public data. Let's try. Okay. So, helping in using the filters. Helping using the filters, direct download, of course, and the possibility. and the possibility also to download via files, CSV files, and also download using WGET. Okay? That we got the connection with the SAMPub to link the VO clients like Aladdin and TopCut. But what is a data center for us? Well, it's composed by the hardware, the software that we produce and support, of course, and by the domain specialist. This is the new feature that we need because of the complexity of the data that's coming in into the data center is so huge that we cannot do without a specialist, at least not only in Trieste, but of course shared between all the communities. So especially for the radio, a specialist for the optical, a specialist for the X-ray, etc. And then once we got a data center, we also need the support of an astronomer domain expert to interface with the astronomical community in order to better understand the content of the data, the scientific content, and of course to help to extract the best information as possible. There are some examples in this, so the ALMA Regional Center in Bologna and the NEAS experience that we did, so for the future 2020 era telescopes. Then we got the experience of the CADC that of course provides some helps in the user space usage. And then I would like to stress on the usage of DOI in order to support also the return of the scientific publications, because once you got a DOI, you got also the possibility to be cited. Then, here to offer web services, as mentioned before, with the connection to the VO, so using the here to SAMP services. This is a sketch of the software, part of the software that we develop in-house. So what was previously shown is the Nadir, the ingestion software, and then the application of the web portals and services. So the services are the TAP schema, the CIAP, the Concert, etc. And then in the upper part, the part related to the authentication, so REP and grouper, and then the user space that is on the left, on the right side. And then we got the analysis and the collaboration tools. So in year two, we offered a single sign-on to approach several kinds of services, the archive as well as the on-cloud for the data sharing if you don't want to republish data in archives. We got Redmine for the project management, the Twiki if you want to collaborate with your partners and collaborators. And then we got Yabi. What is Yabi? Yabi is something that hides the complexity of the pipelines, is a workflow management system, okay? And it's very important because it has several advantages, is very user-friendly. It allows to handle a private pipeline. It is interactive, of course, and you don't need computing power. Okay, that's the main goal. What are the disadvantages for us at the moment is that it allows local management of data, so we do not reingest the product of this because of the teams that ask for Yabi usage don't want to republish data in archives, but we plan to do it. For other purposes, and we are not currently integrated with the remote authentication portal. So, YA2 services are a sort of cloud computing currently because offer both the storage part, the computational part, low computation, of course, and of course, we distribute data. And of course, we offer the state-of-the-art authentication authorization mechanism, and Franco Tinarelli will talk in detail about this. Some details of our app. We use Grouper for the group management systems, so we allow the PIs to add members to their group. And the things that I would like to stress is that we, for the future, would like to have the VO space in place. compliant with what the CADC implementation have, because we would like to use the experiment done in Aging Grade by Sara Bertocco, Giuliano Taffoni, Severin, and Patrick Dowler and Brian Major, in order to make these view spaces talk each other for the authorization part, of course, to assess data and to perform computation. And we know that we got two levels of computation. The first level is the YABI compliant one, that is a user approach to have an interactive usage of the pipeline with no needs of big power of computation and with the small data volumes. So RAP and YABI works perfectly also in the YA2 cluster that is not so big, and it's not for computation, of course, but it could be done. And then we got a user approach using bash processing for HPC and HTC. So we plan to connect with CHIP, that is the pilot project for INAF, using containers or virtual machines. And we had also, with a use case of YA2, a POC with a proof of concept with the Google Cloud. Then we got the publication, and last thing, I'm in time. Okay, thank you. A proposal to the audience is this, using the DOI for the data sets. This means that your data sets are published because they are public once you have done your publication. But, and this feature is supported by the ICT of INAF. But what about creating catalogs of DOIs using additional metadata? So we propose you a form in which you compile some specific metadata and we can publish the data set as catalogs. I would like to discuss this last day, Wednesday, in order to understand better if there is the case of users of this or it is something that is not feasible because the use cases are too much, etc. So the ideal plan is to improve the services offered, so link to proposal submission for each data provider, etc. Increase the number of services offered, so support more pipelines, allow the usage of containers, etc. To reprocess that, etc. For example, see what the REL project will present tomorrow. And hopefully also have in YA2 the basic pipeline for all the instruments. It's a dream, but why not dreaming? Provide data curation before publication. This is a challenging issue for some providers. Increase the number of support data models that are not compliant with the CAOM. It could be, but of course CAOM include a lot of things. Grant access to all the offered services using the SSO, so the single sign-on, and then adopt the VueSpace compliant in order to use both the archive and the computational part. And then data catalogs and publication in order to have also the really the scientific content of your publication. And then this improve, of course, the user experience. Conclusions. The data center has some targets that are to support properly the science, offering archival services, computing power, and maintenance of all the things, because we have to maintain all the software that we have, and that are customized, but because pipeline is something that is not written in the concrete, but of course could evolve. And the target of the storm is to use the data center services to have their own user space to share data with others, etc. To report problem to us, so ticketing systems, and suggest upgrades and usefulness and necessities. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Question? All is clear. No.
Which kind of services you provide in Stella Nave site with 500 of gigabytes of storage?
Unfortunately. Yeah, unfortunately, Seralnave is not working because they have technical problems of the on the dome. But we provide the services of data publication in two ways. The first is the web portals, and the second is a tap in order to assess data in VO compliant manner. Of course, as soon as we have the archive filled with the more data, we will provide also the publication with the VO standards services more specifically for that.
More
other questions? Had you enjoyed the idea of having the DOI, DOI catalog publication? Is feasible for you? Is something that, because usually, if I can, usually once a PI or an astronomer publish a paper, have this data set that is not homogeneous with the publication of others. So this means that we cannot handle each by each user and customize our implementation over that case. But using the DOI, we could probably merge the things, and spending really few moments to fill this form, we can probably have the publication of also the descriptors, not only the DOI, that is something that's static. Yeah, Vincenzo, please. But you don't, but you don't publish the paper. You are publishing the data set that is contained into the paper. So I don't think, but please, the specialist of the publication, if could comment about this. But I suppose, probably.
And you try to understand something and pass sometimes. So you transfer that to the interpreter, not about the data, but just the copyright times, but only about the publication.
The publication, not the data set.
Not about the catalog that we are using for the publication, that article. The article, this data is already under your interpreter for you because it's revolution. And the DOI give you more information about your proprietary interval about that because so I have that link for the papers, but I have also the link for the data set, like you have the link in the data set that is published directly to CDS from Strasbourg, for example. But CDS Strasbourg usually is a single part of your work. Data set can be terabyte of data, for example.
So the answer basically is yes, the paper is private, is under the, but the data set is not part of that intellectual property.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Cristina. Next is Fabrizio Lucarelli. That speak about the SSDC web service.
Okay, so good afternoon and thanks for the invitation to this very interesting workshop. I will talk on behalf of the Space Science Data Center about the main online scientific analysis tools that the data center provide for astronomy. This is the outline of my talk. Matteo Perri already gave an overview about the SpaceSite data center, so I think we can move directly to the description of the Multi-Mission Interactive Archive, the SSDC resident catalogs, and I will show you the application and the use of the science online tools in a few scientific use cases that can be typical for an high energy astrophysicist or astronomer. So we have already seen the Space Data Center is a research infrastructure of the Italian Space Agency whose main goal is to acquire, manage, process, and distribute data from space-based mission, mainly from space-based mission. And it has a large contribution for the, from ENAF and from INFN with the industrial support from Telespazio Cerco for information and communication technology. The SpaceSite Data Center has a wide multi-wavelength experience, both as a multi-wavelength data center, since it hosts the main Agile data center and the Mirror data center for Fermilat, Fermi, Swift, NuSTAR, and also hosts several high-level data and data products and source catalogs from different space missions. All the data and data products are fully integrated in the Space Science Data Center multi-wavelength environment. And there is the possibility to perform cross-catalog searches between resident and external catalogs, and also to extract scientific results and information like the spectral energy distribution sources using some very powerful tools that I will show you later. The gateway to the Space Data Center is this one. This is the main home page, and all of the space missions supported by the center can be seen here on the right. And on the bottom, you can have the direct access to the main science tool like the Set Build, the Sky Explorer, and all the other tools. The same tools and missions are accessible from the top menus. In particular, we also have the possibility to perform for a few space missions a quick look analysis on the data from these missions. In my talk, I will concentrate mainly on these four main science tools. And you can refer for the other tool, like the Matisse tool for the solar system exploration, the Gaia portal, and Agile online analysis, you can refer to this talk in the next day and later. And there is also a contribution to EGRID, and you can see the Fabiano Faustini talk tomorrow or Wednesday. So the Multi-Mission Interactive Archive, we already seen some example of the access to the space data mission available at the SSDC. You can make a query. This is the overall, the whole mission supported in the different area from astrophysics cosmology to exploration of the solar system and particle astrophysics cosmic ray, and also for terrestrial atmospheric physics. You can search for your source target by the canonical name or by coordinates. You be redirected to all the data and data products available for the source that you request for. And you can have direct access to all the data from a specific mission. As I said before, we also host data and data products from a mission of the exploration of the solar system, a database of cosmic ray particles from the main space and balloon-borne experiments like AMS and PAMELA. For example, from this database, you can produce a plot of positron versus the ratio electron plus positrons, which is show the famous positron excess seen by PAMELA and AMS. Also, you can have access to the terrestrial gamma ray flashes, to a catalog of terrestrial gamma ray flash seen by Agile. You can query this catalog and look at their light curve and energy distribution in time. A few words about the catalogs of resident in the SpaceSite Data Center. These are individually accessible from the top menu, but you can also have direct access to all the SpaceSite Data Center catalog. And they span basically a large part of the electromagnetic spectrum from very high energy to gamma rays. All the Fermi LAT catalogs are hosted at the SpaceSite Data Center, X-ray, and we also host catalogs based on multi-frequency observation, which have been used to build the multi-frequency catalog of BLASA and also the catalog of high synchrotron peak Blazar AGN. This is the typical layout for each of the catalogs that we host at the data center. Matteo already showed in more detail the catalog for available from Swift and NuSTAR. There is the possibility to export each table in different format. And also, we have direct each entries in the catalog, each entry is can be directly connected to the multi-wavelength environment. This is just an example from a catalog of very high energy gamma ray sources. If we have a source of interest in this catalog, we can perform a search around the position of our source, and this search opens the Sky Explorer tool, which shows also the other source from the multi-wavelength other band of the electromagnetic spectrum and all the sources of the observation available in the gamma ray domain, but you can choose also other wavelength observation. From this same page you can also directly plot the spectral information about the source you have queried, and you can produce your spectral energy broadband spectral energy distribution for this particular source, which shows also archival data from very high energy gamma ray emission from the radio to very high energy gamma ray experiments. I will show you here now some typical scientific use cases that can be accomplished using the SSDC science tool. One of the first use cases that can be interested to be performed is the quick look analysis of flaring flaring sources. For example, I take as example a recent flaring activity from this flat spectrum radio quasar PKPS 1830. So you can maybe be interested to analyze in a very short time the data of a target of opportunity that you have request in the Swift. And this observation is available, as already Matteo said, in a very relatively short time. And this can be ready quickly to make analysis from XRT of UVOT in the ultraviolet and optical band. When you apply the interactive analysis, you have been redirected to the XRT imaging tool, where you have the count map of XRT in the XRT energy band, where your target opportunity source is clearly detected. And then you can extract further, you can extract further data products. For example, you can perform a spectral analysis and a timing analysis, and you can have directly the spectrum and with the folded model. In this case, I use a power law, but you can also other spectral fit. All this data can also be directly plotted in the spectral energy distribution, so you can immediately have the spectral points for your target opportunity shown in the broadband spectral energy distribution of your flaring source. This I can go on. At the same time, also you can have quick look data from Fermilat, directly querying the SSDC mirror data archive. And you can perform also quick look analysis on the Fermi LAT data, which at the moment is unavailable due to a new release of the data reduction analysis software for Fermilab, but it will be restored very soon. For the Agile online analysis, also you can have access to published data, but with a delay of about 1 or 2 months, since Agile follow a different publication policy, data publication policy. Another example of use of our science tool, of course, is the building of the broadband spectral distribution. For example, you will be interested to perform a classification or modeling of a Blazar AGN. I take as example the standard Markarian 421. When you query for this target, you can load all the spectral data available from the radio to the Vera Energy, both from the SSD catalogs, but also from external services like Vizier and the NASA Extragalactic database. So these are all the band covered by the spectral points. You can perform modelization using a self-synchrotron Compton model of your spectral data. So you can infer the basic main characteristic, the broadband non-thermal emission from this blazar. And you can also perform an analysis in time period, selecting, for example, all the spectral data available in years from 2007 up to 2010. And so you can create a time sequence that you can plot. You can export an animated GIF that show how the time variability of this Blazar AGN, which is quite very high and very frequent. Another example, another use of our tool is, for example, the search for electromagnetic counterparts of the neutrino events seen by IceCube. For example, I just take one of the neutrinos seen in 2016, which has shown any blazar, neither gamma ray, Fermilab gamma ray counterpart. So you could be interested to see if there is a possible electromagnetic counterpart. And you can do it by using the Sky Explorer and Site Builder tool. Just mention also that we find in the Agile data gamma ray transient possible consistent with this neutrino event. So you can query around the position reported by IceCube. And so you can search for all the radio and X-ray source around this position. And in this case, we focus our attention to a source which shown a coincidence, a special coincidence between a radio and X-ray detection seen by ROSAT. And plotting the spectral measurement from this source in the set builder, basically you can infer that this source might be might have the properties of an HBL-like blazar, which is one of the main candidates to be a very high energy neutrino emitter. So you can further inquire this source, making, ad esempio, asking for a target opportunity of the SWIFT data, which we did. And again, you can analyze your trigger of opportunity data from SWIFT using our analyze tool. In this case, we did not find any emission at the position of the HBL, which we suggest as possible neutrino emitter. This is another example. This is the spectral energy distribution for TXS 0506 plus 056, which was claimed as the first source of very high energy neutrinos seen by IceCube. And this source show a gamma ray and neutrino emission correlated during September 2017. And you can see this plot, the spectral energy distribution published in the paper claiming the detection, basically has used archival data from the available from the Space Site Data Center, which are reported here in gray, and the, in green and in red there are the spectral measurements concerning around the observation of the neutrino in September 2017. I want also to stress that in this electromagnetic broadband spectrality distribution, there have been also plotted the upper limit of the neutrino flux flux emission from the TXS estimated over a time interval half a year and 7 years, and this basically you can see here what is called an hybrid SED, and indeed in the SSDC we have calculating and implementing a catalog of new flux upper limits from all the ice cube events seen and published up to now. So you could have also this this hybrid SED once you query a source which is within the ice cube uncertainty position. Just a few words about the VO services. We are in the process to integrate all our catalog entries in the VO services through SAMP connector. And basically, you can export all the catalog, all the table in TopCat. You can, of course, use TopCat for a further reduction and analysis of the catalog parameters. This is just an ongoing process and is available up to now just for a few catalogs. So my summary, I show you some of the main Space Data Center scientific tools, online scientific tools, and I choose some typical scientific use cases and the typical use that an astronomer or astrophysicist can make with this tool. I just say that the multi-web environment of the Space Site Data Center provide several unique features that can be used and can support a large part of the astronomical community, not only for energy astrophysics, but also for cosmologists, and as we have seen, also we have services for planetology and cosmic ray physics. All these services and tools are frequently updated, also taking advantage of the informatic and industrial support. Also the graphical layout will be improved and new features will be added. And of course, we are open to suggestions and to correction or improvement from the astronomical community. This I just wanted to end with all the SSD staff, which is formed by around 40 people, both from INAF, INFN, ASI, and all these are the people from the engineering team from the industrial support. And we also have external support from senior scientists, which help, of course, into not only to make research with our data, but also to make suggestions about improving and upgrade. And of course, there is also Paolo Giommi now, which was one of the main SSDC founder, and I think it's finished. Thank you.
Question?
Yes.
You have SAMP to broadcast data to other new tools. Do you have a way also, if you plan to have a way also to grab data from outside and display it in your web tools?
Yeah, we have a set, we actually, in the set builder, we also get from the VO service VGR and net data, you can include
it. Is that specific to those two services, or does it use a general API, a VO protocol based interface?
I think it's specific for the set builder.
Okay.
I think it used the VO protocol. Okay, now all the VO services have been ongoing this process to all the catalogs to be inserted, and I myself not involved specifically in this part, so maybe Gianluca can be answered. Yes.
At present, the DAP services are working for the Gaia data, for sure.
Okay.
And the other catalogs are available for the SAM.
Okay. Yes.
Come si chiama? Beh, Cristina.
Okay. See anyone else. You can export it in ASCII format and it's yeah. But it is planned also to export it as VO service. This is an ongoing activity. Yes, so you can also export it as VO.
Is that a collaboration with people in
Chambria? Yeah, you see, maybe. Yeah, we got here the TOR, but this is not active yet.
Okay, more? Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Next is Deborah Busonero that speak about Gaia DPCT experience.
So, okay, I will talk about Vitalia Gaia Data Processing Center. This is easy enough facility, and it is one of the infrastructure of UTZ1. I will start from the goals of the Data Processing Center. I presented the team and the data center main activities. Okay, Gaia, I think you know Gaia. Gaia is an ESA space mission to chart a three-dimensional map of our galaxy, the Milky Way. It was launched in December 2013. A nominal mission will end in July this year, but it is extended already to 2022, subject just to a media review in 2020. The Data Processing Center of Turin is one of the six Gaia Data Processing Centers belonging to the Gaia Science Ground Segment. And until now, we receive data since February 2014. We perform a few thousand of workflow, 10 million of jobs, and we have 1.3 petabyte of data stored in our database. We also report the daily scientific activities in the daily reports, and we have now 3,800 of reports. The goals of the Data Processing Center is to develop, implement, and run the Astrometric Verification Unit. The Astrometric Verification Unit is made by two daily pipelines, AIM and BAM, and one cycle pipeline, the Global Spheric Construction, GSR. Also support the GAR experiment, but just via data request execution. In the sense that AIM, BAM, GSR have software system installed at the process center and operates every day at the data process centers. Other goals of the DPC is to provide software, hardware infrastructure, and process capability, data and skills to support the Italian scientific community participation to the Data Process Analysis Consortium. Populate and maintain what is called the Data Process Center Mission Database in Turin, which starts from the raw data, just the raw images taken by the satellite, until to the final data, and also we stored all the intermediate data. The team of Data Process Center is a joint between the ENAF OATO science team and the engineering teams at Altec. Here you can see a scheme with all the people. In the right side, you can see the science team and in the blue, the engineering teams. Okay. I have to say that this kind of experience is very successful. It was very successful, and we found a good collaborations between the science team and the engineering teams. The operations, okay. We have a dedicated team which supervise and verify all the data flow, the world data flow, coming from the Data Processing Center in Madrid, first Data Processing Center we have in DPAC, which manage all the world data chain from the data receiving, ingestion, and archiving. Then also follow the advancement of the scientific pipelines. We also have three payload experts within the Data Processing Center team, which collaborate with the Science Operations Center in Madrid to monitor and calibrate the instruments, the Gaia instrument. The milestone reached up to now are the following. 5 data segments processed, 4 data segments until the end of emissions in 2022. We support the data release 1 and data release 2 catalog delivery. Now is ongoing the acquisition of a data segment 5 and the 3 data processing cycle, which will be used to realize the data release 3. The operation team schedule obviously depends on the mission events. For example, we had VPU switch off, safe mode, decontamination. This is a live missions now. We are in operations. So we have a web portal dedicated to all the operations performed at the Data Processing Center. This web portal can access the scientific team and the engineering team. Here, for example, I'll show you the tab for the AIM management. Here we have the run defined until now, 2,000 of run of the AIM software pipeline. Another example is the Event Anomaly Report tab, which lists all the anomalous events happen on board. Okay, so you can enter here the start time and end time of the period you want, and you can find all the anomalous events reported on board. Okay, but it's just two examples. Then you can see which I call DTS, RMS. The DTS manage the data transfer from the DPC to DPCT. The PFS manage all the workflow and the jobs of a software pipeline. And the output tab, in the output tab, you can see all the output of a pipeline, graphs, statistics, and so on. The data flow. Okay, we received every day 15 gigabytes of compressed data, and every cycle from 10 to 60 terabytes of compressed data. We have three data stores, different data stores, designed with different characteristics for supporting the three different phases of the data management. The local database, which is like a data window that follows mission operation progress, because the local database has just eight months of mission. Then we have the repository database on the right, okay, which is the database which hosts all the data from the beginning of the mission. And then the DRC database, this is a cycle database. The daily pipelines, okay. The IAM pipeline is devoted to raw data processing. It processes from 2 million to 15 million of raw images. The pipeline has a complex structure. It's made of 10 software modules and takes 6 hours for each run. The BAM pipeline instead processes almost 8,000 of images, exactly of fringes, because the BAM is an interferometer, okay, on board on Gaia, and it takes 1-2 hours for each run. These systems, these system outputs, are needed to follow the instrument variations and to calibrate the Gaia instrument. The DRC pipeline is called GSR, Global Spherical Construction, and GSR is solves a linearized system of equation who results gives the Global Astrometric Reference System, position parallax, position, parallax, and proper motions. The solution is compared with that of a main pipeline, as is called AGIS. GSR process from 10 million to 100 million of objects for each run, where run takes from 3 to 6 days, and we need several runs to arrive to the final solution. Okay, the infrastructure of a data processing center. Okay, the hardware infrastructure is composed by 40 servers for computing processing, okay? Then we have also a development and test environment made by 7 servers. The DB servers are 3. And we have the DB server 3 and are based on an Oracle Rack technology. The database management system actually is the 12.2, but we need to migrate before the end of July to the 18.5 version. Then we have 3 levels of backup: a level 1 backup on prime storage array, a level 2 on disk, it is called store once, and is in the figures, where to backup. Also, we have a level 3 backup on tape libraries. These three levels backup guarantees us that we can preserve the data, and we are sure that we don't, we can not lost anything, okay? Because our goal is to maintain this kind of a database from raw data to the final data for also for the futures, okay? For science exploitation. Okay. Gaia, the Data Processing Center is devoted to the operations. So the database is a live database. Okay, is not already an archive. Okay. But we want to, from now, to experience some data requests, astronomers' data requests, especially to support the performance verification calls. These calls came before the data delivery, each data delivery. Until now, up to now, we completed 27 data requests. We can follow the data request. An astronomer can open a data request via the Gaia Jira web portal or the DPCT web portal. Since this performance verification call deal with the intermediate data, not all with catalog data, this kind of a data request have to be open only from the DPAC scientist, okay? We need to perform this data request, the Data Processing Center Operation Manager, the Data Processing Center Database Administrator, and the enough astronomy domain experts, for example, data scientist, okay, for the identification, preparation, and extraction of the required data. This nodules is not trivial. Okay, so we cannot use spatial base features, okay, because we don't deal only with the sources, but also with a whole universe of intermediate data, 1,000 billion of entry, with not trivial relations, rules by Gaia data models and other particular features. So these are just one small step, okay, towards a data exploitation platform, which will be the Living Sky and beyond. You can follow the Lattanzi talk on Wednesday about that. What I want to stress here is that the mission database at the Data Processing Center in Turin will be a precious resource also for the execution of new calibrations in the futures, for new scientific experiments, for supporting new missions, and also to perform multidisciplinary activities like study about radiation damage on the L2 environment effects on the instruments. Okay? And I think that we need to find a way, a road, okay, to preserve this kind of database, this kind of data, to for the exploitation of also the future community.
Thank you. We have time for one question. Okay.
Just a question about the database you use for the organization. In particular, do you use Oracle?
Oracle, yes.
For all data type, all data kind, all data level?
For all data type or data kind or data level, yes, until now, yes, because we choose Oracle in the 2008, okay, at the before the start of operations, so we needed to frozen the technology at the moment, okay, and now it's not possible to change for the operational, okay, features, okay, so for the future. We don't know. Oracle is well, okay.
Sorry, what about MongoDB in the previous development phase?
Oh, it was abandoned by other community in Gaia, but I don't know. If you can, Roberto, if you wanted to answer to Stefano or Angelo, so just about this point.
I think that the choice comes from opportunity in terms of standard. So the Italian team, the industrial requirement, put the choice of Oracle. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. No, Daniela Bettoni says speak about the web archive.
Okay, I'm here to as a user of the archive, and I would like to show you the main characteristics of this archive. Okay, first of all, let me briefly overview the instrument. The Weave is an instrument that is going to the William Herschel Telescope. It has a large field of view of 2 degrees and almost 960 fiber for each plate to plate of 1.3 arc seconds. You have 3 different modes, MOS, and then you have the possibility to have 20 mini IFU of 11 × 12 arc second, 1.3 arc second in SPAXLs, and also a large IFU that is 1.3 × 1.5 arc minutes, so with a lower resolution. Probably this will be the first one that will be used in the science verification that we are discussing about this, but this one. You have a low resolution mode in this range of wavelength, and with 2 arms, the red and the blue arm, and there is also a high resolution mode that have different ranges of wavelengths. Weaver is mounted on the first focus of the William Herschel, and this is a sketch of the 2 arms. So you have the blue arm, a red arm, 2 plates, and the slit, and the, so that you can have a very good coverage in wavelength and in resolution. There are sets of science team that work in various fields. The biggest one is galactic archaeology with a lot of subsurvey. Then there is a stellar sequence galaxy cluster that has 3 layers, and that is the only one that probably will use also the mini IFU and enlarged IFU. And then we have aperitif for radio steps for that is leaded by Angela Iovine and Bianca Poggianti of ENAF that is going to study in great detail, going very deep in sulfur brightness. This is very a challenge for this instrument because they need 7 hours of each field to reach the goal, scientific goal. So it's a very challenge because you need 7 exposure of 1 hour. So you have to be careful when you do the schedule. And low far quasars and white dwarf that are a layer, but also that are used for the calibration because in each field there will be a set of white dwarf. Here is sketch of the timetable that now we are the construction is more or less complete. The assembly probably is was supposed at the end of this year, but it's not like this. It's the beginning of the next year, and we hope that the first science lies in the last part of next year. We are finally going to the final step that we can have data, and all data has to be checked. And this you can see one, the survey. We hope that at the end of next year, all the surveys start and will be ready to go. And for to do this, there is the archive. The archive is managed by people in at TNG. And here you have a very simple data flow of what happened from the science working group that give the input, scientific input, OCS that give the observation on the telescopes, and here you have the operation, and then finally after the Cambridge processing system that calibrate data, the operational repository in Cambridge, and finally in Tenerife there is the advanced processing system that make the measurements of data. All this data finally and in the Weave archive at TNG. And the Weave archive, and I would like to show you that this is the very simple scheme, but at the beginning was like this, slightly complicated, but the first one was this, that is very complicated, and they said, because you have a lot of passages, the raw data go in Cambridge, and then go back, and then, I don't show you, but it's a little bit very complex. But the main point is that the Weave recollect data. They are reduced in Cambridge, measured by APS in Tenerife in ESA, and then finally send to the archive. And you have that this is done by daily basis, every night, each run observation is send also in was the raw data. The every 3 months there is also the reduced data in wavelength and flux, and every 3 months probably there will be also the catalogs. And so you have all the documents that give you the timetable. This is the timetable we plan. We have a proprietary period of data, which is more or less 1 or 2 years. And then after 2 years, 24 months, there is a data release that we will plan to announce with a paper from which we can give the main result. And you have here the different data releases available. There will be also open time that people from the community can apply as a 10-15% of the instrument. This is the data preservation. There will be 2 backups, one in Trieste at our archive system, and the other one in Groningen. So there is a duplication. This is the from Marcello, that this is the what we think about the total size of data that we produced at the end of each, I think, night. And this is the Weave interface. The Weave interface is mainly thinking of to take data, not to work with the data, simply to have a quick look and to be able to retrieve both spectra. If you want to retrieve the unreduced data, yes, you can, but I suggest not to do. Retrieve the reduced one. And then you have a username, a password that you can use, and this is the final interface in which you have the possibility to add a custom. A custom because for stars, we plan to have catalogs of hundreds of indexes. So you can select on the basis of the temperature of the star, of the color, of what you want. For galaxies, you can select on the basis of radial velocity if you want, for example, to separate a cluster or some other different galaxies. And so you can customize your final search on the archive. And then this is a typical output in which you have the different objects with their identifier and the main data, which are in general coordinate and magnitude. You can add other values if you want. And this one is because in general, when you have a wave observation, is not one single observation, but is more than one. You can have two or three. And so if you click here, you can have a sub-menu in which you have the number of spectra that contributed to this one, and you can search this one. If you want, you can do a search by subclass, and you can do also some very raw visualization. You can have the histogram of one parameter, a scatter to degree, a heat map, or if you want, you can have take your data in FITS, VOC, or CSV format. And finally, you can select what you want. Because we have a red, blue arm, the stacked spectrum, the single one, and so you can also select which one you want to have on the go. This is a typical example. We have done a lot of rehearsal with the simulated data, with the archive, and one of the main point that happened is that in general for galaxies, we would like to see which one is the object that we are, for which we have the spectrum. And so we decided to have this very simple visualization in which you have the spectrum, and here is a connection with VO, in which you can have with the coordinates the object. So you can see if it is a correct one or not, because it's not easy when you have a MOS with 900 objects. In addition, you have the possibility here to plot only the red arm, the blue arm, and also we check with the redshift. You can see here the lines. We decided to put some typical absorption or emission lines, and then you can overplot those lines using the redshift. It's a simple quick look, but to see if the measurements that have been done are correct or not. And it's useful to see if we have to ask a new measurement or not. In general, we checked with the simulated data. Now the programs that are used that for galaxies are Sloan for based pipelines, tools for the measurement of velocity dispersion and indexes, and the PPXF from Michele Cappellari for the radial velocity, and then we see that they're working very well. And here you can see a zoom of the spectrum for a part, and so you can see that it's possible to see the lines plotted over in the range of the redshift. And here another zoom in which you see the two features in absorption. This is an early type galaxy. And here you have an example of typical east plots that the archive can do, which are this is the distribution of magnitude of the sample that I selected. This is the velocity dispersion. And so here you have a scattered plot of the object in a region of sky. So it's very basic archive. It's mainly an archive that gives you the possibility to take data. This is the purposes of the Weave Archive. You can look, have a quick look to be sure that your object is the one that you want, and then you can take all the data. And the data are all reduced and ready to be measured if you want to do again new measurement. But if you want, you can retrieve also the catalogs with the measurements. I suggest to retrieve measurements that we checked a lot and they are good. And this is to show you with the various operational rehearsal that we have done, the number of objects that we measured and we obtained in the different OCS, GPS, IPS are reduced in wavelength, measured. And so you can see that they are now growing. And then we have selected more or less 1 month of observation that we have simulated, and then we are now analyzing. And here you have the time that take the archive. One night in Gestio is 40 minutes, and the whole of PR2.5 that are 10 observing night simulation take in 6 hours. in the archive of TNG. And so that at the end of this, we enter as observers in the archive and we take all the data. And this is an example of some results that you can have for the various surveys, the white dwarf, the magnitudes, and so on. And then you can see that we can immediately have the numbers. And finally, we have the possibility to go with the virtual observatory. This is the last step. We would like to send all the catalogs to the VO. In so that to give the maximum visibility for all the data of WIVE. Our intent is that when the data are public, we public all the catalogs, all the reduced spectra, and all the people can use all the data that WIVE is going to produce. And we are implementing the TAP also for to send the table. You can take tables from VO table, so you can read with TopCat or so any other one that you want to send to Aladdin. But we are implementing also a direct access from the archive. Thanks.
Okay. Question?
Level, yes, they are available. You can retrieve also that one, but they are in the archive, but not immediately visible. You have to ask for the raw data, and then you can take the raw data, of course, and also the intermediate steps. You can see.
If I want the spectrum and the sky.
Yes, you can have both. Yes, yes, they are separated with a keyword. Yes, we are discussing about keywords to insert for to have the sky, because for the mini IFU, the problem is the sky. And so we decided that we left one mini IFU empty, and this is the sky. So it's the solution, the best solution that we can have, of course.
Okay. Ricardo?
Another policy, which is the data policy?
Data policy, okay, yes, the data, very strict. I am in the WIVE editorial board, we are discussing a lot of this. Okay, this is the WIVE data can be used by all the builders and all the people that are inserted now in the list that is on the web page of WIVE, and they can use the data, and they have free access because they are part of each survey, the galactic archaeology and galaxy, and then you can use, and then you once you have used, you can propose a paper, send a paper on the web page in which as the editorial board we evaluate, and then you can publish the data. If you are outside of the people that are inside this, you have to ask permissions and so, but is a new from 2 years ago, 2 days ago, that there was an agreement in the board that now Italy has a free membership, in the sense that if anyone wants to add to the science team in WIVE from Italy, it can do. Simply ask. Ask to Antonella Vallenari, which is our in the board.
This means that the data we don't have
the proprietary period is 2 years, but for but all the people that are inside the collaboration can use. Have a password for 2 years. Yeah, 2 years.
2 years
from the first data release and then so on. Yeah.
Cristina?
There is Marcello Lodi and José Guerra and Emilio in Canary Island and
Adrian
the column of the yeah, because I ask always something new and then he solve my request.
Okay. Thank you. And now Now, Diego Paris, LBT, from data to users.
So I am Diego Paris, and I collaborate with the LBT Survey Data Center team in Rome. And I work for the archive of the scientific products, which is the main topic of this talk. So the LBT Survey Data Center has been set up in 2007, and it is a service that has supported the Italian community in the exploitation of the LBT observation. So it deals with the preparation and the collection of the proposals and their storage into the LSC archive. Also, it supports the observer from the before and during the observations, so it allows the possibility to store the OBs, to get the finding charts and the visibility plots, and also notifies the APIs about the availability of the raw and reduced data. Also, it offers a service for the data reduction using pipelines developed ad hoc. Finally, it distributes the reduced data to the, APIs, so we can say that this service supports the Italian community from the call for proposals to the publication of the data. LSC fits into the LBT Italian data lifecycle, and so in this slide we can see that LSC is surrounded by the red dashed line, and the green elements represent the operating units we have developed in Rome. We will focus on in particular way on this operating units. Briefly, the LBT Italian Data Life Cycle begins with a new call for proposal. We have a new call for proposal every year at LBT, and the LBTO staff with the LBT Italia team encourages the PIs to submit every year a new proposals of observing programs. So, within a certain deadline, the proposals are submitted, and all the information is stored into our archive, and this is made by the proposal handling system, and the specific database of our archive is LBTOBS. After that, a time allocation committee, the TAC, meets in order to evaluate the proposals and ranks them on a scientific basis. So all this information is stored into our database, and the LBTO staff prepares the observing schedule that is forwarded by our system to the observing team at the telescope. So observations are actually executed when the requirements are actually satisfied, and after that all the collected data are stored into the Tucson archive. And the data are also fetched, are also mirrored to our archive into the LBTDB database. Also, these data are so ready to be reduced, so they are given to the data reduction operating units. We have an imaging data reduction pipeline in Rome, developed in Rome by us, and a spectroscopic data reduction developed in Milan. We will focus on our pipeline in this talk. Later we will see that encourage to ask the Milan team for further details about the spectroscopy pipeline. So the reduced data are stored into the archive, and are distributed, disseminated to the PI owners for their publication by the last operating units. Now we will focus on these operating units. So the LSC archive is the very core of the LBT survey data center, and it is built by three MySQL database. So we have LBT ops that store all the information about the proposals, the scheduled observation, so the observing runs, the observability of the targets, and the observing blocks. We have LBT Red, TDB, that collects the raw data and metadata, and LBT Red that stores the reduced science ready data and metadata. This is the genuine scientific data flow. So after the observation, raw data are collected into the Tucson Central Archive, and then they are fetched, they are mirrored to the LBT partners. So to the American partner, the Italian partner that is ENAF, and the German partner. Also, the data are given, are distributed to the PI owners with a latency about 1 day. And also, the data, the raw data, are mirrored to our archive in order to be reduced by the imaging data reduction in Rome and the spectroscopic data reduction in Milan. In a time scale of about 2-4 weeks, the reduced images and spectra are so distributed to the PI owners. So the proposal handling system, every year the LBT Italian Coordination Facility announces a new call for Italian proposal at LBT. So in collaboration with the LBTO staff and making use of the PIT is a GUI that has been developed by the LBTO staff to generate and submit the proposal. It is important to remark that since the current year, the proposals are submitted in an anonymous way, and this to avoid possible gender bias during the evaluation by the TAC. The TAC evaluates and ranks the proposals, and all the proposal is handled by the proposal handling system that stores all the information about the observing runs. Then the LBTO defines the schedule, optimizing as much as possible the execution of the programs, and also the PI are asked to give all the needed information, so BIS, finding charts, and masks for spectra, and so on. Finally, making use of the LSC portal, the PIs can check the status of their observing programs during the year. Now let's see the service of data reduction. Like I already said, we have two operating units, the LBT Imaging Reduction Facility in Rome and the LBT Spectroscopic Reduction Facility in Milan. Essentially, the imaging pipeline reduces images from LBC and from LUSI and NIRCAM in infrared filters. And the spectroscopic facility in Milan reduces MODS and LUSI spectra. So let's see in details the pipeline, the imaging pipeline. It can be described as a three layers architecture. So we have an external layer represented by a Java user interface that prepares a reduction XML sheet from an instrument XML model. So we have a specific instrument XML model for each instrument. It is important to remark that this pipeline has been used for different purposes. So we have ported it for the reduction of large programs for VLT. So we have reduced data from VIMOS, OKAI, and FORTS at the very large telescope. The intermediate layer is the very engine layer, is represented by our Python script that puts in communication the external layer with the inner layer, and parses the information and continuously exchange information between the two layers. The inner layers are represented by a suite of C programs written in C language that performs operation on images. So the reduction products, mosaics, weight maps, root mean square maps, are, and the metadata are stored into our LSC database. This is the general imaging pipeline workflow. A few words about it. So raw data are first corrected for the crosstalk effect that arises in the case of multi-amplifiers detectors, such as LBC. And then the extolled data are pre-reduced, making use of the calibration data. From the pre-reduced data, we create the bad pixel mask in order to flag artifacts on images, and the object mask in order to flag the contribution of the sources. Making use of these masks, we create background maps, getting rid of the contribution of artifacts and sources. And so we, by subtracting these background maps to the pre-reduced data, we obtain the calibrated sky subtracted images. These images are then corrected for astrometry distortions and are given to SWRP, which that resembles the images on a common grid and stack them to obtain a final mosaic and a final ancillary weight map and root mean square map. This is, I've added a pair of slides to see the products of our pipeline. This is M16, also known as the Eagle Nebula. This is the combination of three filters, G-Sloan, A-Sloan, and I-Sloan. The PI is Dave Thompson from LBTO. And the combination is about 10 minutes for each filter. This other product is from an Italian program whose PI is Francesca Nibali, and the target is UGC1249. This is the combination of two filters, 1 hour in G-Sloan and 1 hour in R-Sloan. A few words about performances. For a typical LBC dataset of about 15 raw images, 1.2 gigabytes. The time consumed needed is about 1.75 hour with a rate of 0.7 gigabyte per hour. And for a Lucy dataset, 36 images, 0.6 gigabyte, the time consumed needed is about 0.5 hour with a rate of 1.3 gigabytes hour. This without considering the calibrations. This slide, I do not comment this slide, but this is the general workflow of the spectroscopy pipeline. So please contact the Milan team for further details about it. So now let's see the LC portal. Okay, so this portal provides a restricted area for the administration, so for the back-end operations, restricted area for the observer, and a restricted area for the users, the PIs. Also, it provides a series of tools, such as the exposure time calculator. This is the panel used by the observers to manage the information about the observing run. Each row is an observing run. Also, it provides the target observability calculator that computes a plot of the observability of a target given some inputs. And this observability is stored into the database. The green cells you can see are good dates, good periods, when to observe a specific target. I'm already... and this is the panel for the used by the PI for the data for the reduced data. So the PI can select the reduced data and download on its on their client. The system architecture is built on a LAMP architecture, Linux, Apache, MySQL, PHP. The total LBT DB size is about 4 terabytes of raw data. The number of PIs, Italian PIs, that have used the service is about 30. And the LBT red size is about 700 gigabytes of reduced data. The number of proposal ingested is about 450. All this data in the last decade. So just a snapshot of our machines. The left track, machines are dedicated to the web server and archive, while the other rack mount is dedicated to the machines for the reduction data. Last slide. The last call for proposal expired last May 17, and the TAC is now going to evaluate them. We've got suggestions from customers during the years, so we continuously implemented new solution to keep our service update. And Dulcis in fundo, don't hesitate to ask for help. We do our best to satisfy our customers.
Grazie. Okay,
I'm done.
Cristina?
Super fast questions.
two questions. No, only one.
On PI
user,
access.
You got the password for each user, you got the password.
From PIs, users,
sorry.
Exactly.
For each user, so each user has a server program. Okay.
Exactly.
No, no, only one. The next. Ah, okay.
Do you expose only Redux data or also intermediate products?
Sorry?
Do you expose only the Redux data or also the intermediate products?
No, we store all the only the reduced data, exactly.
For the Italian partnership.
For the Italian partnership.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And now for Agile, we expect a talk of Pittori Carlotta, but we change with Lucarelli because Carlotta had a problem.
Ciao Carlotta.
Okay, so good afternoon again. Carlotta, Pittori apologize not be able to come, so I will talk about the Sense Operation, Agile Sense Operation Center, hosted at the Space Sites Data Center on behalf of the Agile SSDC team composed by Carlotta, myself, and Francesco Verricchia. So just a few words about Agile. It's a small mission of the Italian Space Agencies with contribution for the NFN ENAF. Is dedicated to the gamma ray astrophysics in the energy range from 13 MeV up to tens of GeV. And its scientific payload is composed by three main detectors, an hard X-ray energy imager super agile on top of the main detector, which is the silicon tracker gamma ray imager grid, which is sensitive in the, for gamma rays in 30 MeV, 30 GeV. And on the bottom, we got a mini calorimeter for the energy estimation of the gamma rays detected by the gamma ray imager, which can also act as a gamma ray burst detector in the energy range between 0.3 and 100 MeV. Agile was launched more than 10 years ago by an Indian launcher in 2007, The Agile telemetry is downloaded and received by the antennas, ASI antennas in Malindi, and then sent to the ASINET satellite communication to the mission operation center in Fucino, and then the telemetry, raw telemetry, sent to the space data center, which hosts the Agile data center, scientific operation center. This is the ground segment, the overall ground segment architecture from the telemetry download to the Malindi, and these are the activities both for the Mission Operation Center and the Agile Data Center. Basically, the MOC in Fucino is devoted to the satellite control, to the flight dynamics control and the Mission Control Center, while at the Agile Data Center operate a science scientific operation center, and we perform all the activities related to the mission planning, the real-time data processing and data calibration. We produce and store the long-term Agile grid data, the data for the gamma ray images, and also we perform the quick look analysis. And we, of course, have an interface with MOC, sending the long-term plan and the observation planning file. These are the main tasks executed at the Agile Data Center, hosted at the SpaceSite Data Center, as I said before. And also we perform, manage guest observe programs and announce some opportunities. And also we distributed all the data and software to reduce, to analyze, the scientific software to analyze the data to the scientific community, plus other online services that can help to analyze the Agile data, and I will talk about it later. So at the ADC, we performed the real-time data processing. We received the raw telemetry from the Fucino, and we transformed the raw telemetry in FITS data format, and we go all through the data reduction chain up to the generation of a photon list at the spacecraft log file with housekeeping and rate meter information that we'll use for the quick look data analysis, which is just for internal Agile users, and then from the level two, from the level one data, we generate the final public standard analysis level two data. These photon list, public and standard photon list, are then used to build the high-level data products, level 3 data, CavMax, Spectrum, and Light Curves, that have also been published. All these data are archived at the Agile Data Center. These are all the scientific operation and the ground segment activity performed at the Agile Data Center. As I said before, the interface with the Mission Operation Control. And regarding data processing and their archive, we have the management of the automatic real-time data processing pipelines, the archive management, data backup, and also we are in charge of directed data analysis. And from time to time, we also handle the announcement of opportunity guest observe program, and we also take care about the publication of the Agile mission web pages and catalog, Agile catalog web pages, and give user support for Agile data analysis. So we have different kind of user, internal DC operators, the Agile team scientists, which are also are part of the Agile collaboration, and are mostly enough people. We also end the Agile Guest Observer program, and we are the interface with the scientific community. We have an internal interface between the Agile Mission Relational Database. We can give access to all the data data in data products at all levels. And we, through this interface, we can also monitor the automatic pipeline processes. We can also navigate between all the data and also to the quick look standard data processing. This is just a snapshot of the database query, which retrieves the level one data levels, agile data levels. So in total, the agile data archive, just concerning the gamma ray image detector, occupies about 1 terabyte per year. So since the start of the mission, we are at the level of the 11 terabyte, including all the data levels from raw data up to level 2, level 3 high level processing data. Just a few words about the scientific capabilities of Agile. Actually, Agile was started as a pointing instrument, but at the end of 2009, due to a problem with one of the rotation wheel, it changes to the spinning observing mode, and basically now is an all sky gamma ray detector which can image all the gamma ray sky in 7-8% of the gamma ray sky every day. This is an intensity picture of intensity gamma ray map above 100 MeV, obtained summing all the data from the pointing plus spinning up to September 2017. Of course, Agile cannot, it's a small mission and cannot compete in terms of sensitivity with Fermilat, but we have one of the strengths of Agile is the very fast ground segment and data reduction processes. Basically, from the telemetry download up to the first photon list log file available, ready, for the extraction of scientific products, it can pass a time of about 2-2.5 hours, and we have also optimized and reduced these latencies after the telemetry download, and in half an hour we can have the first photon list. And this was optimized for the gravitational wave counterpart hunt, which is ongoing already at this moment. So what I said before, all this agile data reduction and processing chain was optimized for the gravitational waves for the direction of electromagnetic counterpart in gamma rays of the gravitational waves. And in particular, we also make use of the mini calorimeter data and also of the anti-coincidence panel data, which can be used as burst detector on very short time scale. This is the O3 run is ongoing. We are very active, and I can show you one of the first gravitational wave event. This is the gamma ray, the agile grid exposure. Since Agile is in spinning, basically should run, but at the trigger time of the gravitational wave, we did not cover the LIGO contour, but we were on it approximately after 6 minutes with a good exposure. So we can place an upper limit very close in time with the gravitational wave trigger. These are all the alert from the LIGO and Virgo receives so far since the starting of the O3 run, and we are basically have reacted and follow up all these alert. Of course, we have not detected any significant events in correspondence of the GV alerts. And this is the control loop that we are using basically real time in order to check the status of the telemetry download and the data processing. We use this just to have a real, very quick knowledge about the status of the agile telemetry and the data processing status. So just to end, I want to show you that at the Space Science Data Center, we have implemented an additional analysis, scientific analysis tool for the analysis of the Agile grid data. It's so-called the Agile Level 3 web tool, which has also been used by students, high school students for training, and just to have there is an Italian program of the ministry which allows students from any school to get close to astronomy, to astrophysics. So this is the standard multi-mission interactive archive which I've shown already before, and from this interface you can query the level 3 archive from Agile, which is formed by pre-computed counts, exposure, and gamma ray diffuse emission, which are the main basic block used by the scientific Agile analysis to extract gamma ray significance, light curve, and gamma ray spectrum of a source in case of a detection. So you can query this archive, which is formed by a block of different time interval, which can cover 2, 7, and 28 days. And basically, once you have query at a certain position your archive, you are proposed with all the level 3 Agile grid level 3 building block. From this building block, you can choose, for example, the 28 days duration. You can build a light curve directly on your target, and this is a very useful tool because you can generate a light curve which spans the whole entire Agile life in a few minutes, and you can export all your flux measurements in case of a detection again in the set builder in order to build spectra distribution and make of course you can will have here all the measurements at different epochs from the Agile grid archive. You can also perform an interactive analysis bin by bin, which is basically redirect to a kind of web page like the one I showed before for XRT or Mustard. So in the future, there will be an update of this online Agile interactive analysis. In particular, now we use as a reference catalog the second Agile catalog of catalog of sources, which has been recently published. And we also make an update with the last version of the scientific software and calibration. So basically, I just want to stress that this tool was meant in order to help user from the astronomy community just to make the analysis directly on using the SSD server without any need to install the Agile software locally on their machine, and also without the need to download the data, which in case of, especially if you want to make a very very long light curve or a very deep count of the exposure map, it might be very time consuming, and also it will mean a download of very large file and heavy file as the log file are, because the spacecraft file are the most heavy part of the Agile data published. And so I finish.
Question? The last question of the day.
Question of the day.
No question.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Ci vediamo domani alle 9. Si può dire in italiano, sì. See you tomorrow. Vuoi aggiungere qualcosa?
No.
Thank you.